Okay, Boker Tov. Today's daf is Nun Vav 56, and we pick up at the top on Rav Letame, five lines down. Basically, what we had been discussing was we once again were revisiting the issue of what type of a boundary would demarcate two separate fields for the halach of chazaka, that if you do chazaka on one, it doesn't work on the other. This would be by nichse hager, fields that are ownerless, because if somebody is selling them to you, then the fact that you've paid for them would make it define it as relating your chazaka relating to both fields, or the fact that somebody's trying to transfer it to you could define your chazaka as relating to both fields, according to one gemara, right, even if they're completely separate locations. But if they're hefker, then the sort of physical reality has to define itself as going on both. So if there's a boundary line, a boundary marker, or some type of a mound between them, or trees, or whatever, grass that is used to demarcate the boundary, what works on one does not work on the other. And the question is, what would be in other areas of halacha? So yesterday we explored peya. Do you give two separate corners or one corner on the two fields? And tuma, when there's a question about a doubtful tumah in the private domain, according to Rabbi Eliezer, that's only if you definitely went into the field. But if you don't know if you went into the field at all, then you would be tahor. So is it defined as one field or two fields? So there was a debate whether this type of a boundary marker for those halachot would define it as one field or two. And then the Gemara ended up by saying that when it comes to Shabbos, it would definitely be one field, but Rava would consider it two. So what is the relevance for that? You know, why don't we just pick up with that again? We'll repeat what we did at the end of yesterday. So let's pick up at the bottom of Nun Hey Amud Bet. So the Gemara says five lines from the bottom. Avol Shabbos lo. For Shabbos purposes, this boundary marker would not define it as two fields. Rava Amar Afilin in Shabbos. Even when it comes to Shabbos, it would be two. Now, what is the relevance for Shabbos? We're going to see it's not about fields. It's about some type of a division of a Rishut HaRabim, of a public domain. The time that we taught in the Brisa. Hotzi Chatzi Grogeres, the Rishut HaRabim. You took out half of a pressed fig, meaning the quantity, the volume of a half a pressed fig, because for Shabbos, you only transgress. There has to be a minimum size. So only when the thing you carried, if it's food, is the size of a pressed fig. So you carried out half that amount into a public domain, from a private to a public domain. And you put it down, and you then did another one. Okay, so do those two acts combine to be one act, right? Like, for example, when you're eating something that's forbidden, what defines that it's one act is that it takes place, the time it takes to eat half a loaf of bread. And if you eat them more distant from one another, right, then they're two separate acts and they don't combine. And so if you did a half year and a half, 2 hours later, you haven't transgressed. So here you don't have the time period per se, but it's halamacha, one state of having forgotten. You didn't remember in between that it was Shabbos. Because here the question is, you're doing it unintentionally. And do they combine to obligate you to bring a korban chatas? So if it's one state of forgetting, you haven't remembered in between, those combine and it's like you did one full act of carrying. But if there's two acts of forgetting, because in the middle, oh my God, it was Shabbos, I shouldn't have done that. And then you forgot again, and then you carried again. That defines it as two separate acts. Rabbi Yossi Omer, now Rabbi Yossi says, even even if it's one state of forgetting, you're not always chayev. They don't always combine to form one act. If you bring them into one domain, into the same public domain, then we define it as one act. Now, Tosfos, by the way, points out that another Gemara makes it sound like it's not even enough that it's in the same domain. You have to put it down in the same place, right? We could bring it out to the same Broadway, and we could bring it out like a mile apart on Broadway, okay? But this Gemara says that it's enough if you bring it into the same domain. You've brought a minimum amount of food from a private domain into a public, and it's the same public domain, even though they were two separate acts and two separate half measures, that's your chayev. If they're two separate public domains, patur, you're exempt. So now, according to Rabbi Yossi, it becomes interesting to ask, what is defined as two separate public domains? I mean, there's obvious cases, right? You know, you got, that they're separated from a mile from one another. But what would be the minimum definition to define them as separate public domains so you would be exempt if you brought half an amount into one and half an amount into other? So that's going to be a debate.
So yes. He's adding, in other words, up until Rabbi Yossi, there were two criteria. which is quantity and awareness, as it were. And he's adding space.
Well, right, meaning I mean the quantity, right, is taken for granted, but what would define combining two half measures would be the lack of awareness, the continuity of the lack of awareness.
Right.
And he says you also need that the act is done in the same place.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So what is defined as the same place? The Amar Rabba, so Rabba says, to define it as two separate places, there has to be a obligation of a sin offering between them, which means a domain which would be defined as a separate biblical domain that were you to carry into it, you would violate Shabbat biblically. Which means what? For biblical purposes of Shabbat, there's only two domains that matter. A private domain, which is defined as a space surrounded by four walls, maybe three, whatever. Okay, and a public domain, which is a major thoroughfare. Most of the things out in the world, you know, outdoors, like, you know, all the homes are private domains, but most of the things outdoors are neither a private or a public domain. Those are a carmelite. Okay, so if it's not a major thoroughfare. So for Rava to say, for this private public domain to be separated from the other and us to consider them two, there has to be a private domain between them. So that were you to carry from one to the other, you would transgress biblically Shabbat. But if there's just a carmelite, you have a major street, two major thoroughfares, and they're combined by, you know, side streets. So those are not private domains, but they're not public domains. That is not enough to separate it. That would be considered effectively one public domain. Okay, so that's what Rabba says. Just make it two so that you would be exempt. If you brought half into one, half into the other, it would only be if there was a Rishut HaYachid between them. Of a Carmelite, low. A simple Carmelite, something that is neither private nor public, would not separate those two public domains. Abayamar, I feel a Carmelite. No, even a Carmelite. As long as it's a public domain ends and something else begins, and then another public domain begins, that would be two separate public domains. Aval Pisla, if you had a Pisla, which is basically like a type of a raised platform, okay, so you really had one street, okay, it was one street, but in the middle of the street you had, like, you know, I'm trying to think of an example. Yeah, an island would be a good example, or like when they have those, you know, those cones in the middle. What are those called? Not those cones, those pillars, you know, those plastic pillars they sometimes have to divide a highway or something like that, right? That might be a good example, okay? So something like that, right? That's not a separate, you, that's not even a carmelis. That doesn't separate it into two public domains, all right? And Rava says, Rava Amar, a few pieces, no, even something like that, if it demarcates it and physically separates it, even if it's not a different reshus for Shabbos purpose, you know, it's all within, technically, the reshut HaRabim, to consider it two separate acts that you brought half into one and half into the other, and they don't combine to be one act, that is enough. So that's like Rava's idea before. That's the consistent with what Rava said earlier, that a simple, like, demarcating line divides something into two domains for Shabbos purposes, according to Reb Yossi, that it matters that we define it as two domains. As to Rava l'ta'ame, Rava goes according to his reasoning. D'amar Rava, reshus Shabbos ki reshus gittin dami. Okay, but by Shabbos, the idea of separate domains is similar to the idea of gittin. Now, what does that mean? Where does this matter for gittin purposes? So, the Rashbam says it's referring to a case in the Gemara in Gittin where a wife is standing in a husband's yard, and the husband throws the get to the wife.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and now the sense, now it has to fall into the wife's domain. So the sense is that the husband transfers to the wife ownership of the sort of the space that she needs to be kohen her get. But let's say that she is not, let's say that the get doesn't fall on the ground, the get falls on a little like platform. So the Gemara there says, then she's not divorced. Because the husband, we assume, is kohen one space to her and not two spaces. So he could be kohen to the space she's standing, but something that's on a little platform, even though really it's like in the same yard, that would be considered separate. And since it would be considered separate, it would not implicitly be included. So therefore, that shows this idea that even something as trivially different as this, like a little platform in a on a ground, is considered a separate space, and that's relevant for gittin. Rabbeinu Gershom says it's a different type of a halacha. The halacha that I think, let me just double check. I think he says that you have to be omedes b'tzad sadehu. 1 minute. Yeah, he says that the halacha that that there has to be hivikita b'makom echad, that you know, for get to work for the ground to work like a yad, like an extension of the person, you have to be standing in the same zone where the get falls. So he says a little different, that if it fell on this platform and she's standing on the ground, it would be considered falling in a different zone, in a different space. So the same way by Gittin, that's enough of a difference to consider it a different space. The same would be true for Shabbos purposes. Okay, so that is sort of wrapping up or revisiting this issue of when you do a chazakah, one, is it one plot of land or two plots of land, and looking at it through the lens of other areas of halacha. Yes.
In the case of the dried fig, what's the connection between forgetfulness and time sequence? Like you said, if you did it 2 hours later, it would not be considered one act.
Right. So an act
what
of eating
remembered through that whole time.
No. So by an act of eating, we say it has to be kedeach yos pras. So like if somebody, for example, eat, you know, sometimes when people are, you have to eat on Yom Kippur, if there's a question, if it's enough to warrant actually, you know, violating Yom Kippur, some rabbis will say you eat like a little less than the amount and then you wait 5 minutes or 9 minutes and then you eat another. So for an act of eating, it has to be within the amount of time it takes to eat a half a loaf of bread to be considered a continuous act of eating. For this, it's not the question of the passage of time. It could have been 3 hours later, but to be considered one period, it has to be that the person throughout that period forgot that it was Shabbat. And if they remember at any time in between, that breaks it up as a ongoing process and defines it as two separate acts. Okay. All right. So now the Gemara says like this. Ein sham lo mitzar velo chatzav mai. If there is no boundary marker or no, we'll see in a minute that chatzav is like some type of a plant, trees or grass, you know, that define, I guess it's more of a natural boundary marker, that define the edge of the field, what would be the halacha?
There, now, there is a plant.
What?
There is a
plant. Oh, that's the name of a plant?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. What type of a plant is it?
It's... I have a picture.
You have a picture of it? Okay.
It's what they buy for weddings to make a machitza between the land and the
women. You're kidding. Okay, I thought it was descriptive. You're telling me it's the actual name of a plant.
Like,
great.
I don't know. Otherwise, I wouldn't have said.
Yeah.
Said that it is.
Yeah. No. I want to hear what it is.
It's like
there was a note here that said that there's a picture in here. I think if it's the same one we mentioned yesterday.
Yeah, it was.
The roots go straight.
I know. We're going to see about that. Yeah.
Okay, that's so the one. Okay.
Yeah.
The way we're taught.
Yes.
It's called chatzav because it's chotzev ba'adama.
Right.
So it's a bulb, and it like starts in the fall. Because when it's still dry and it's like it
goes straight down,
and then the plant is
goes straight up. So that's what we're going to see, right? We're going to see that's going to be a plant that exactly goes straight down and straight up. So it was planted specifically to serve as a boundary marker. Okay, so yeah, please let me know what the name of the plant is. Okay, so now the Gemara says like this. So now what does this mean? What would be the halacha if it was not marked? So the Rashbam says that, let me just double check. Right, how much would you be kone if you had this field of Nichse Hager that did not have any clear markers? So maybe he owned a large, big property. How much would you be kone if there was no clear marker to demarcate the edge of it? Now, that's a funny question, because you could say if there's no marker to demarcate the edge, you would be kone everything. Everything that he owns, right? If it's all continuous property. But maybe the Gemara for the Rashbam is saying, no, you know, if normally it's defined by conceptually one field, so what would be that conceptual definition, you know, that definition in the absence of a marker? So the Gemara says, so ein sham lo meitzav lo chatzav mai, so pirsh rav meromis mishmo, so the Rashbam says it means in the name of Rabbi Yochanan, who was the one who mentioned the statement before, right, about the Meitzar v'chatzav mafsikim b'nichse hager. So he explains, so what would it be? My, so pirsh rav meromis mishmo, kol shenikris al shemo. Anything that is called by his name, anything that the people say, oh yeah, all of that belongs to, Ploni, to Reuven. Okay, so if people recognize it all as his field, that defines the boundaries, even if maybe he owns more, but the extent to which it's all called one person's field means you do a chazaka on a part of it, you're kona all of it. Again, if it's hefker. I'll get back to you in a second, okay? So hey chidami, what would be the case? Amarav papa de karule begar gargusa de planya. They call it the place that of irrigation of so-and-so. Gargusa means, okay, 1 second. Okay, we're getting back to the Chatzav, don't worry. Okay, where so-and-so waters his field. Gargusa apparently is the area that's being watered by this person. So for the Rashbam, in the absence of a boundary marker, we still have to say, when you do a chazaka, like you turn over a piece of ground, you don't kona all the land that the ger owns. It would only be the extent that's considered one unit. And therefore, we would define the unit by the extent to which people recognize it as all belonging to this person's field. That's the way the Rashbam understands the question. Again, how much when you do one chazak in a small space, what's the extent to which it's kona in a case of a hefker field? The Tosfos understands it differently. If you look at Tosfos, in Sham Lo Meitzar, Tosfos says, Atumakai, Kinemucha Behed Yavatosefta Dataros. That this is going back not to the question of the ger, but to the question we dealt with yesterday of if you have a doubt whether you went into the field, is it a case of suffik tuma that you're tamei or suffik tuma that you're tahor? Can we say you definitely went into the field and you don't know if you went over it, or you don't know if you went into the field? What defines one field or two fields? So then we would do this definition of kol shenikrei sal shemo. So again, a little unclear whether we're looking back at that earlier definition of one field or two fields by the ger or this tuma definition. Okay, now we're going to get back to this chatzav, okay? So here we go. Yosef Rav Acha bar Avya, coming to Revi Asi. Yosef coming Mishmei to Rav Asi bar Chanina. Chatzuva mafsik p'nichsei hager. So we've been mentioning this chatzav. So this chatzuva, this plant, divides with nichsei hazer. My chatzuva, what is this chatzuva? I'm Rav Yehuda Marav, Shabotichem Yoshua Yisrael et Aretz. That's the plant that he used to divide up the land, that it would be very clear, like, you know, serve as a natural boundary of which shevet gets which land, and within each shevet, which family gets which land, okay? And that's the plant that he used. Now, why did he use that plant? So here, if you look at, I'm getting there, okay? So if you look at the Rashbam, Shabo Tichain, he says, Bein Shevet L'Shevet, Bein Ish L'Ish, L'Fi She'eno Yonek, Lo Mikan V'Lo Mikan. So that goes, the money goes straight down, so it doesn't spread out in either direction. The roots go straight down, the grass or whatever, the plant goes straight up. So it's exactly as you were saying. Okay, so now what, you got a picture for me here? Sea squall. Okay, so what is it? Sea squill, a plant with a large bulb that produces green leaves in the winter, dries up completely during the summer. At the end of the summer, it grows a large inflorescence, white flowers, da, 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 da. Its roots are very long, and its bulb generally planted deep in the earth, so that it's difficult to remove completely. Well, that makes sense. If you want to use it as a boundary marker, you want to make it hard to remove. Because of its tall, straight form that returns annually, sea squill was used to demarcate boundaries between fields in both ancient times and even in some Arab villages in the modern era. Okay, so that's very interesting. All right, so that says that even until today, that this is used in, apparently not just because it grows straight up and straight down, but it also says because it's hard to fully remove.
And there is a note that it's poisonous.
Oh, really? So people keep away from it also.
I mean, like, now you can see in Arabic villages the cactuses, right?
Uh-huh.
The cactuses are like...
Oh, they use that to create a boundary.
Yeah.
Oh, very interesting.
Like,
okay, great.
It's same because it won't siphon off the nutrients.
Right, because it goes straight down. Right. Okay, excellent. All right, very good. All right, so... Now that we're mentioning that Yoshua used it to divide the land, we have a fascinating digression in the Gemara. Let's take a look. It's the same Rav Yehuda Marav. So part of the reason we're quoting it is it's the same sort of, person who's saying it, the same tradition, but also it loosely relates to this point about bounding off the land, you know, using this plant to create this natural boundary. Lo mana Yoshua el ayirot ha'omdot al ha'gvulin. In Sefer Yehoshua, it only listed the cities that were at the borders, because those are the relevant cities. You know, there's a section in the Yoshua where it lists all the cities they conquered. Those are the relevant cities to know because those are the borders of the land of Israel. Of course, Tosfos says that's not true. If you take a look at Tosfos, he says, "Homedes al gvulin, ein lefarash al gvulin shel Eretz Yisrael, the kama yeros chashiv shem be'emz Eretz Yisrael." Right, and this city's there that are in the middle of Israel. Ela bigvulim dechol shevet v'shevet. It must be that the cities mentioned were the ones that also similar to this idea of using this plant, right? So you see the parallel to mention the cities that are boundary cities, border cities between various tribes. Okay, very nice. Now, Amar Rav Yud, Amar Shmuel, Rav Yud, not in the name of Rav, in the name of Shmuel, Kosharei HaKadosh Baruch Hu Moshe, Chayiv B'maaser. When God shows Moshe, you know, gets at the end of Dvarim, you know, Varei Hashem Es Kol Ha'aretz, Es Gilad Adan, Veis Kol Eretz Naftali, Veis Ephraim Ufnasha, right? So all of that, that is the land of Israel that's Chayiv and Maaser. Okay, La'afuke Mai, what does that exclude? La'afuke Kini Knizi V'Kadmoni. So by Avraham, if any, you know, when God says to Avraham in the Bris Ben Absalom, I'm going to give you all these lands, it doesn't mention seven Canaanite nations, it mentions 10. And three of them, the Canaanite, Kenizzi, and Kadmoni, are not mentioned elsewhere when the Torah mentions the seven Canaanite nations. So the rabbis were sensitive to this, and they said, what happened to those three extra lands? So it must be that those lands are not Eretz Yisrael proper. Now, what does, and therefore they're not Chayiv and Maaser. Now, what does the relevance of this? First of all, the first point Tosfos makes is, it's a little funny that the Gemara points to the vision of Moshe, because there actually is in the Torah a much clearer demarcation of the land of Israel, which is in the end of Bamidbar, where it says, these are the Gvulot, right? And it specifically draws the Gvulot. So Tosfos assumes that they're basically the same. He notes that, you know, the Gemara really should have said that. That was more specific. Okay, I don't know why. He doesn't have an answer. But anyway, let's talk about what the Gemara means, that the rest is not Chayiv and Trumos and Maaser. So Rashbam says what that means is that even if they were to conquer those extra lands, they would never become incorporated fully into the land of Israel and never be Chayiv and Trumos and Maaser. Now, that might make a certain amount of sense. You know, it could be land that's owned by Israel, right? You know, but it's not Eretz Yisrael proper. Like, you know, you think about these, you know, Great Britain, right? It had all these lands that were part of the empire, but they weren't Great Britain proper, right? Or Rome, right? So you could have land that's owned by Israel and not Israel proper and not Chayiv and Trumos and Maaser. The problem is that there's a whole major Gemara that discusses the status of Syria. Syria is presumably some, like Syria, some trans-Jordan area, okay, that because it was conquered, would be like the land of Israel and would be obligated in Trumas and Maestros. And the only issue the Gemara discusses is that it was Kivush Yachid. It was privately conquered. Now, what does privately conquered mean? So some say it means that David did it without getting specific license from the Sanhedrin, or some say that David did it because he did it before he conquered Eretz Yisrael proper. But the point is that everybody there agrees that if it was Kivush Rabim, if it was done in the proper way, it would be incorporated into Israel and would actually be Chayiv in Trumas and Maestros. So the Rashbam seems to say, okay, maybe those are the lands that are immediately like, you know, juxtaposed, immediately contiguous with Israel. Those could be incorporated. But let's say Israel were to go to war and to conquer, you know, France, okay? So it would be a Kibush Rabin. It would be done with the Sanhedrin. It would be after they conquered Israel proper. Would that be Chayiv and Trumas and Maaser? Maybe certain lands, even with the idea of Kibush Rabin, are so distant that they never become incorporated into Eretz Yisrael proper. So that's what the Rashbam said is being said here, that these lands of Kini, Knezi, and Kadmoni, which is fascinating because it's part of what God promised Avraham. So even though it's part of what God promised Avraham, says the Rashbam, even when you conquer it, it's not part of Eretz Yisrael proper. It's not Chayiv and Trumas and Maaser.
Because it's so far away?
Maybe. He doesn't say why. Because when the Torah repeats what you're going to get, it only says the seven Canaanite nations. And in Bamidbar, it says, this is the land that I promised, you know, Asher Nishbati Lavasam. So it's only those that. This is some type of messianic vision. And because it's some messianic future vision and it's not the real promised land, therefore, even when you conquer it, he says, it is not part. Yeah, I mean, let's read the Rashbam. Let's read the Rashbam together. He says like this, Chayiv b'maaser. So it's a line starts with b'maaser. It's about 10 lines before the Mishnah. Even in the future, we deserve them. They're coming back to us. We're going to get them. Even though they're promised and we're going to get them, they're still not Eretz Yisrael proper.
Those
These were extra. This is not the Iker land that was promised with a Shvuah. This was some future promise. And the amazing thing is that even though there's sugyas in the Gemara about Kivush Rabin becomes part of Eretz Yisrael, this presumably is so is too distant that it doesn't become it, even though it was promised.
You think it'd be closer?
I know, but he must imagine that it's further away than Surya, because the Gemara thinks that Surya could be Chayv in Trumas and Maestros. So that's the Rashbam, pretty wild idea. Tosfos makes this a little bit, tames this down a little bit. Tosfos says, no. All what the Gemara means is that Tosfos makes this sort of not saying anything that new. Tosfos says, this Gemara is assuming Kivush, that Kedusha Rishona Kicha L'Shaita V'Kicha Lasi Lavo. What defines the land of Eretz Yisrael to be obligated in Trumas and Maestros goes by what they conquered in the time of Yehoshua, and not by what they conquered in later generations. So even if they conquer more in later generations, it's all defined by the time of Yehoshua. And therefore, all that this is really saying is that these lands were not conquered in the time of Yehoshua. Okay, so then it's not really such an interesting statement, because we sort of knew that they weren't conquered in the time of Yehoshua.
What do you mean by Yehoshua? Okay? What about with David and Syria?
So that Gemara presumably understands Kedusha Shnia is Kicha L'Shaita L'Asid Lavo, the discussions of Surya, of Kivush Rabin. Okay, but this discussion. Oh, you're right, I'm sorry. Shnia, you're right, is the time of Ezra, right. That's a good question in general. Like, that must understand that the Kedusha Rishona probably continues through the end of the Bayis Rishon period. You're right, it's like it doesn't end with Yehoshua. I mean, that's in general that question of that discussion of Surya, right? Because is it assuming Kedusha Rishon or Kedusha Shnia? It seems like, so yes, but even so, let's take a look at Tosos, okay? Let's read Tosos. Chai v'maser, v'im tomar, v'klolu, is this a general rule? V'alo harbet krochin kip shenol le mitzrayim v'lo kip shemol le bavel v'lo nischayiv b'maiseh af pi sheherem l'moshe. He says, anyway, you go by, you go by what happens in the time of Ezra, when that defines it. Yeshom et kasaber kedusha rishon kicha l'shait v'kicha l'asi bavo v'ashtenicha shelo tikshi kol asimai dasi v'asi krochim shekip shol le mitzrayim v'lo kip shol le bavel. Okay, because he basically, according to Tosfos, all it's saying is that the whole land conquered by Yehoshua is holy and not the land promised to Abraham. So according to Tosfos, all that it's saying is that don't think, and this is actually an interesting point, right? It's the difference between the divine promise and the reality. Don't think Eretz Yisrael for Trumas and Maestros is defined by the divine promise. Even if God promised it to Avraham, that is not what defines Eretz Yisrael. What defines Eretz Yisrael is the reality of what they conquered. And since they didn't conquer those lands, therefore they do not have Kedusha for Trumas and Maestros. Okay? By the way, though, it raises an interesting question. Because that's a good question. Maybe that's a question about, they did conquer Syria. They didn't conquer these lands. But I'll tell you the interesting question here, because the question is, what is the point anyway about the boundaries? Now you're going to see my terrible.
There's two systems of boundaries in the Torah.
Okay, well, that's actually with the Sinai. Okay, anyway.
Is that not
so,
relevant here? There's two
yes,
systems.
Yes, well, yes, meaning, what do you mean? Avraham and then what it says in Bamidbar.
Yes.
Yeah, so that's exactly what it's dealing with. Okay, what is the relevant of the boundaries that the Torah draws? If the issue in the Gemara is that Kedusha Rishona, you go by what was conquered by Yehoshua, why does the Torah tell us the boundaries? I mean, let's just see what Yehoshua conquered. So maybe it's sort of telling you what we're expecting to get and what you should try to conquer when you go in the land, and they didn't always finish conquering everything. So, maybe it's not to tell you this is what is Kadosh, but this is what I'm giving you, and this is what you have to try to conquer. But is there a relevance for the boundaries in Bamidbar for this halacha of Trumas and Maestros? So if the Gemara says Kedusha Rishona Kicha L'Shaita, it goes by what they conquered in the time of Yehoshua.
That's
Olam Yitzrayim. So the question I have is, let's say what they conquered in the time of Yehoshua, right? Let's say they conquered. Exactly. Let's say they conquered, this and this and this, and maybe they had a little problem here with Gaza, and they conquered this. But the boundaries were given like this. Does the fact that you look at it as one unit and you say they basically conquered it, right? There's some areas they have to finish up, but they basically conquered it, means that it all has Kedusha. You don't measure inch by inch and mile by mile. Say, this little piece they didn't conquer, that's not Chayv. No, you don't say that. You say, these are the boundaries. They basically conquered the land. The rest is you know, mop up mitzvah, and therefore it's all chayiv and trumas and maaser. So I think that it works in some combination of the two. So exactly like that. So what the Gemara is saying is, if this is the Shiva Samanim, and over here is Keni, Knizia, and Kadmoni, let's even assume that it's attached, okay? You don't say that just because they conquered this, that this has Kedusha. This is distinct. So that's what Tosis is saying. The point of this is we're going by the Kedusha Rishona, we're going by what Yoshua conquered, and that works for the land, even if it wasn't 100%, that Moshe saw, the land that was drawn out in Bamidbar. It does not work for the land over here.
So I want to apply specifics to what you just said.
Yes.
So in the time, so in the Milchamot against the Plishtim, the time of David HaMelech,
right.
So Ekron and Gat and all those lands
right.
were Philistine, according to this, they would have Kedusha.
Yes, and that's what Michael's asking too, right? How long do you view this just as Yoshua as an ongoing process during the entire Beit Rishon period? The Gemara's discussion about Surya, which was conquered by David, sounds like you look at this as an ongoing process, okay? But lands that are outside of these boundaries, it would only go by exactly what was conquered. All right, so and just saying you got this doesn't automatically bring in other lands.
Conceptually, I totally get what you're saying and how it's reflected in Tosafot, for example. Why was there a question, for example, with Beit Shan? Beit Shan is like
that's by Ikshani. So that assumes that you don't go by the time of Yoshua, you go by the time of Ezra. And then the question is, did they re-sanctify it and resettle it in the time of Ezra?
So that's a fundamental.
Yeah, there's a major debate whether you go by the time of Yoshua or the time of Ezra.
According to both Rosh Barmantles, even if you would conquer Keni, Kinsey, and Kamoni, this is of course the Fuke.
Right, but according to Tosas, that might mean assuming we're going by Kedusha Rishona, what they conquered in the time of Yoshua doesn't have relevance for Knizia Kadmoni. Tosas is not excluding the possibility that if they actually were to conquer Knizia Kadmoni, it might actually be Kadosh, especially if you go by Kedusha Shnia. Okay, he's just saying the conquering of Yoshua doesn't automatically schlep in the status of Keni, Knizi, and Kadmoni. All right, but that's assuming Kedusha Rishon. If you went Kedusha Shnia, it'd be different. All right, so now the Gemara says, what are these lands? Okay, so Tanya, Rabbi Meir Omer, Naftucha Arva'a Vesalma'a, I guess. So I don't know, what does it say there? Nebatian, what is it? What does it say the lands are? I mean, Arva'a is probably Arabia, right? What it doesn't give you the English there? Okay, those are the lands he identifies. You'll tell us in a minute. Reb Yehuda Omer, Har Seir Amon Moav. Now that makes sense. Those are the lands that actually, that's a fascinating read. Because those are the lands that are immediately borders Eretz Yisrael. And not only do they immediately border Eretz Yisrael, what's significant about those lands? Har Seir Amon Moav. Those are Esav and Lot, right? Exactly. So those are the lands that Bnei Israel are told, do not conquer it. Ki Yerushan Nasati Et Yino Leisav. Right? So it's a fascinating read. Avram gets promised. Think about this a minute. Avram gets promised Kini, Knezi, and Kadmoni. You know, they actually do go to Avram's children or Avram's family. Who do they go to? Lot and Esav, which are part of Avram's family. Just not you. Just not Bnei Israel.
God has a separate covenant with them.
Exactly. So that is like an amazing read of the Psukim. What happened to those three nations? They did go to Avram's family, just not the Jewish part of Avram's family. Yeah. They went to these, right? And because they've been sort of given to those, you don't have rights to them. So that's like an amazing read. Rabbi Shimon Omer, Ardiskis Asya v'Aspamya. So Asya is apparently Asia. Now Aspamia, when we had it before, I read it as Spain. That was a completely wrong read because I checked, and at least what do you call it? Sansino says it's a name of some other country in Asia. It is not Spain. What does this say?
Aspamia refers to northern Syria.
Northern Syria, and what's Irdiscus?
Oh, these are places.
Asia Minor.
Asia Minor. Okay, and what were the other ones? What were Naftucha, Arvan, Salma?
Well, he says these are places. Ten nations, and he skips some.
Okay,
but he's saying that these lands situated south of Eretz Yisrael from Dead Sea to Eilat.
South, really?
That's what he said.
What the first group?
Yeah,
the first group. Oh, really? Somewhere here? Somewhere where? Somewhere in Egypt?
Well, it says south of the Dead Sea.
Oh, this is Arabia.
Dead Sea to Eilat.
I don't know.
Southern portion of eastern Transjordan extending to the northern Arabian.
But Asia is over here. Asia Minor, yeah, right?
That's three different opinions.
Three different opinions. Okay, very interesting.
So does that mean that, like, let's say, like, halachically, like, there's a question, let's say, if you're a lot, do you have to keep
Yeah, 2 days. Yeah, but part of that has to go with Kedusha Rishona, Kedusha Shnei. It all has to depend. Okay, let's go. Next Mishnah.
Even let's mention it. Lots made some cover.
Right, so but that's part of the question. Do you go by Kedusha Rishona? Do you? There are three realities. I mean, there's more. There's
what
the Torah says. Well, first of all, there's what Avraham was promised. That's what we're discussing. But there's what the Torah says when it draws the boundaries in Bamidbar. There's what they actually conquered in the time of Yehoshua. And then there's what they settled in when they returned in the time of Ezra. Now, there's actually more realities. Because in the time of Yehoshua, it continued through the time of David. In the time of Ezra, it continued through the time of the Hashmonaim. Right? So there's a lot of different things you could look at. Let's take a look at the Mishnah. So that was a fascinating little digression. Back to standard Baba Basra issues. Hayu shnayim idim asosh achla shalosh shanim v'nim tzu zamanim. Okay, so now we get some mako stuff. Okay, so two people said you were here for 3 years, and they said that David was on my land for 3 years, and it was going to be awarded to David, and then it was found out that they were all lying, that they were all with somebody else in a different place, classic Edom Zomim. So they were trying to make me lose my land. They have to pay me for, you know, the value of the land. So Mishalmi Moetako, they pay me the full value. Now, Shnayim B'Rishonim B'Shnayim 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 B'Shlishis, let's say David brings three sets of Edom. You know, the first set says David ate year one, the second year two, the third year three, and they were altered at Zalmanim, Mishal Shalim Beinayim. Then you divide it. Each one of those groups of Edom pays a third of the value of the land. Right, because they did it all together. Now, 2 points. Number one is this phrase, Mishal Shalim Beinayim, is used in the Gemara in Makos to say exactly this, that the Edom have to sort of divide it. If there's multiple Edom, they divide the obligations between them. But, you know, one of the questions asked in Makos is, why does it use the word Mishal Shalim, which is from the root of Shalosh? You divide it into three. So part, it might be that this is the root of it. Because it comes from, this is the you know, the original version is where there's three groups on three separate years. So it says you divide it into thirds. Okay, and then it's used as a sort of metaphoric to just mean you divide it proportional to the amount of people that were involved.
Actually give him like
No. They use Mishal Shalim for, that's not the context. For Edom Zomim means that you divide the monetary obligation between them. Now, number two is Tosus asks a question. Tosus says, why can't the first two groups of Edom say, we weren't trying to award the field to David. We weren't trying to steal it from Dov. We were actually testifying that David ate Dov's, you know, grain, you know, illegally for that year. And we were trying to help out Dov. We weren't trying to help out David. So even if we were lying, who knows? Maybe we owe the cost of that year, of that field, of that year of grain to David, but we don't owe the cost of the field to Dov, right? How do you know what they were? So Tosa says it depends who brought the Edom. Okay, if David brought the Edom and he brought all three groups together, clearly you look at them as one big unit and they're all coming to take the field away from me. And if they're all lying, you divide it among
them.
Six Edom's open. Okay, now, Shlosha Achim, Be'echad Mitztaref Imahem. Let's say those three groups were actually made up of three brothers, Reuven, Shimon, and Levi. Reuven testified to year one, Shimon testified to year two, Levi testified to year three. The Echad Mitzar Vimam. And then you had some fourth guy, Mordechai, who was unrelated, and he saw all 3 years. So group number one was Shimon and Mordechai. Reuven and Mordechai. Group number two was Shimon and Mordechai. And group number three was Levi and Mordechai. Okay, so does that work? So the Mishnah says, those are three separate testimonies. It's not like you say, oh, brothers can't testify on the same thing. Because each year is a distinct year, it's not considered to be like two brothers are testifying on the same thing. One brother's testifying on year one and one on year two, so they're distinct, so that works. But when it comes to the idea that if they're all turned out to be lying, then you view them as all combined working to achieve one thing, to award David the Chazakah. And therefore, they all have to, nobody pays his Edom Zomim until it turns out like that they're all lying. So they're seen as one big, you know, set of sets, if you would, for Hazama purposes, because together they all achieve one thing, but it's not one edus, and therefore it doesn't matter that there's one brother on 1 year and one brother on another.
So it doesn't matter what they actually saw. Let's say all three of them really did see him 3 years, but just, you know, since he actually needs to have it halakhically acceptable, so you could have said your first year, second year, or third year, you know, like meaning right. Like one of the brothers. But then he brought this Mordechai, and so it happens to be that officially Mordechai and Reuven says year one, and Mordechai and then Shimon says year two.
Right.
Though they could have gone.
That's a good point. If all three of them saw all 3 years, you might then sort of coach them to only testify in 1 year each, so you don't have an issue with the brothers. That's a good point. Yes, and that would probably be fine. Okay, now the Gemara says like this. Masnisin, thank God, excuse me for saying this, we're not going to get into Adim Zogim, okay? We're getting into so many different things. We're going to focus on one particular aspect of this Mishnah. Masnisin, delok Rabbi Akiva. It's not going like Rabbi Akiva. Tanya, I'm Rabbi Yossi. Kishalach Abba Chalafta, Eitzel Rabbi Yochanan Menuri, when Abba Chalafta, which apparently was his father, this is Rabbi Yossi ben Chalafta, when he went to Rabbi Yochanan Menuri, Limot Torah, to learn Torah, the Amri Lay, Rabbi Yochanan Menuri, Eitzel Abba Chalafta, Limot Torah. I love this. They don't know who was the Rebbe and who was the student. Okay, so I guess they were pretty much colleagues. Anyway, so one went to the other to learn Torah. Amalo. So whoever went said to the other one, Harei Sha'achle Shana Rishona, Bifnei Shnayim, Shnia Bifnei Shnayim, Shlishis Bifnei Shnayim, Ma'u. So one, you know, we're finally asking, I mean, it's so quite big of a question, right? How do you bring proof that you've had a chazakah? Who's going to have witnessed you on there continuously for 3 years? So let's say you have one group of Adim that witness year one group that witness year two, one group that witness year three. Forget Adim Zomadim. Do they all combine? What's the story? Mahu. So Amar Lo, Harezo Chazakah, they combine. Amar lo, Avani Omer Kein. You know, I think so too. Ella, she Rabbi Akiva cholik b'davar, but Rabbi Akiva thinks it doesn't work. Why? Shai Rabbi Akiva Omer davar, apish nay medim yakum davar, velo chatzi davar, not half. So since any 1 year is not the full statement of chazakah, you could even go further. Any 1 year proves the opposite of chazakah. 1 year that David's eating in my field proves that David owes me a year of my grain. So, but certainly, and the one testimony is a partial chazakah. It is not a full chazakah. And you need that Adin testify to a full matter. And he says they don't combine. Okay, that's a very high demand. Very hard to get Adis according to Rabbi Akiva. Okay, for Rabbanan, hi davar v'lochati davar mayavid. Now for the rabbis, the Gemara assumes that the rabbis would agree that you can't have testimony on a half matter. But this is not considered a half matter. What would be considered a half matter for the rabbis? So this is the question of testifying that a girl has reached puberty and is considered an adult. So it is actually, I mean, it's a uncomfortable Gemara because it talks about like two strangers, because the father can't testify, men, looking at her pubic hair and identifying that she has two pubic hairs. Okay, so, and two, see that she has one from a front view, and the other see a different one from the back view. Okay, so in that type of a case, maybe the two testimonies can't combine. So the Gemara said, I'm sorry, no, first we said one witness sees the front view and one sees the back view. So the Gemara says, that's not just a half of them. Two testimonies can't combine. When we say two testimonies can't combine, it means you have two witnesses for half A and two witnesses for half B, and they don't combine. In this case, you have one witness for half A and one witness for half B, right? You understand the difference. You don't even start with a full set of witnesses on anything. So that obviously is not true. It doesn't even need a pasuk. Two say they saw pubic hair from the back, and two say they saw it from the front. And in that case, they can't combine. Now, why is that different than 1 year, 1 year, and 1 year? So the Rashbam and Tosos have two explanations. The Rashbam says, because 1 year, 1 year, and 1 year, when you're witnessing the 1 year, you can't see year two. You've seen everything there is to see during year one. Okay, so that's not a chatzi davar. But if you were standing there with the girl and you could have gotten the whole information and you only got half the information, then that's a chatzi davar because you could have seen everything. Okay, and therefore, the fact that you had all of that information available to be seen and you only saw half that was relevant, that's chatzi davar. That's the way the Rashbam explains it. Tosa says it has nothing to do with that. I don't care if you could have seen more, you couldn't have seen more. What Tosa says is the difference is that when you testify to 1 year, it's like what I said before, that testimony would be meaningful by itself in a different context. How would the testimony that David ate a year of my grain be meaningful even if it were not a chazakah testimony? I told you before, how is it relevant? Then you'd have to pay me back. So since that testimony could stand independently to serve a different purpose, it's considered a full davar. okay, and therefore can combine with two other years to make 3 years. The testimony of one pubic hair is meaningless. It doesn't serve anybody any purpose in halacha, and therefore it doesn't combine. It doesn't stand alone to combine with other things. Okay, so everybody agrees that it needs to be full, but Rabbi Akiva's definition of full is very demanding. It has to be the total testimony. All right. Now, Amar Rav Yehuda. Now, here's another interesting application of this question of a full or partial testimony. Echad Omer Achla Chitim, Echad Omer Achla Seorim, Harei Zo Chazaka. One set of witnesses say that you ate for 3 years grain. Another set of witnesses says, no, I mean, you know, wheat. Another says, no, yeah, you ate those 3 years, but you weren't eating wheat, you were eating barley. So he says it combined.
I'm sorry, is it a set of witnesses or just one witness?
No, witness. Achat means one group, kadachat. Okay, no, you're right. No, you're right. I'm sorry, you're right. One witness. Right, you're right, because we're combining it to be two witnesses. Thank you. Okay, one witness says, thank you, you ate 3 years of grain, and one witness says that you ate of wheat, and one witness says you ate 3 years of barley. Harei zo chazaka, that combines. Now, why does it combine? So one way of understanding why it combines is because sometimes we abstract, particularly if you're dealing with dine mamonis. So let's say Michael here says, I borrowed $100 from Michal. And David says, I didn't see whether Dov borrowed $100 from Michal, but what I did see is that Dov, promised her or whatever, damaged her property and owes her $100 for that purpose. Okay. So maybe that's a little bit of an extreme because it's a damage and a borrow, but whatever. Or Michal gave over $100 that he, you know, and now he has to give it back. So both of you, if we abstract a little bit, if we say concretely, are you testifying that the same act took place? No. But if we abstract, you're both saying that I owe her $100. So there actually is an opinion in the Gemara that we combine your testimonies and say I owe her $100. Because you're saying I owe her $100 and you're saying I owe her $100 for totally different reasons. But we combine them to say I owe her $100. What? I know. So there's a debate about that. So the Rashbam says that that's what we might be saying here. You say I have 3 years of chazaka for eating wheat for 3 years. You say I have 3 years of chazaka for eating barley for 3 years. You're not testifying to the same thing, but each of you, if we abstract it, are saying, yeah, I had chazaka, so we'll combine it to say there's ages that I had chazaka. Yes, Michal. Okay, so that's the question. That's the claim. So Maskifler Rav Nachman. Rav Nachman asked about this. Elameato echad omer achla bishonu shlishis v'chamishis echad omer achla shnia revius v'shishis hachinami davi chazaka. So if one said you ate years 1, 3, and 5, and the other said you ate years 2, 4, and 6. Are you going to say that that's a chazaka? Now, that combines? Now, the question is, wait, that's different. If they're not continuous, neither to aid is testifying that you had a chazaka, right? Saying discontinuous years are not a chazaka. So Tosa says, no. We mean that presumably there are times when if you have discontinuous, it is. Remember, if you like let it lay fallow, because that's a normal thing, is to let it lay fallow in the intermittent years. So Tosa is just saying that what the Gemara's real pushback is, can you really say the testimony that contradicts itself combines for a chazaka? Okay, because in this case, all right, if I say, if Michael says I borrowed $100 from Michal, and you know, and David says she gave me $100 of her to watch or something of that nature, okay, you're not contradicting one another. You're not saying the same thing, but you're not contradicting one another. But if you say 3 years of wheat and you say 3 years of barley, or you say 1 year, years 1, 3, and 5, I harvested, and 2, 4, and 6, it was fallow, and you say the reverse, you're contradicting. So it's very different to say that we can abstract and combine to say that when they contradict, we can combine. So how does this work? So Gemara says,
to mean when he says 2, 4, and 6, to exclusion of 1, 3.
Yeah, that's why Tosfos is reading it. Not because I didn't happen to see it.
Otherwise, it doesn't make sense.
Right, exactly. Rashbam has a different read, which I'll tell you in a minute. So it says, "Amr Le Rav Yehuda, Hachi Hashir." What type of comparison is that? Hasam b'shata de kamasi mar lo kamasi mar. Here they're not saying the same year. Now that sounds like not just they're not contradicting, but they're not talking about the same thing. maybe you don't even have to contradict. They're not even
they
testifying.
Are, he's saying not 2, 4, and 6. So
yes, but no. But the way the Gemara reads now is it seems like they're saying you're saying half and you're saying half, and you're not saying the same thing. You're not meaning you're not that you're contradicting, but you're not testifying about the same years. And
are,
therefore, we can't come up. I'm saying the read now is saying even without saying explicitly what happened in the intermittent years. Okay, but. Here they're both testifying the same 3 years. Okay, but you're contradicting. One says wheat and one says barley. So my ikalamemer, what is bothering you? So you know what? So okay, one said wheat, one said barley. People don't pay attention. Who knows the difference between right, exactly. If it was wheat and vegetables, wheat and fruit, then it wouldn't combine. Okay, so the way in the end, what's clear in the end is that the Gemara says it works when it's a type of a normal mistake, and the Gemara has this other type by Eidus that we say people were like imprecise, and that's not really a contradiction. What's left open is the question of is it similar to the case of each of you say I owe Michal $100 for a different reason, right? So if you actually say, right, that I have, what if you had that case where you were not, it sounds like, according to the way Tosfos reads the conclusion, that it doesn't work in the same way. If you say it's year 1, 3, and 5, and he says 2, 4, and 6, and you don't know what happened in the other years, and he doesn't know what happened in the other years, it still seems like we wouldn't say, or let's say either. You say years 1, 2, and 3, a straight continuous chazaka, and you don't know what happened after. And David says years 4, 5, and 6, and he doesn't know what happened before. Would we combine those to say chazaka, right? Or would we not? Would that be like saying I borrowed $100 and or I owe her $100 for a different reason? So that's left as an open question. At the end of the day, what we know is the reason it combines here is because we're saying they really are saying exactly the same thing. They just got the details mixed up. But how much can we abstract and combine is not clear. Now, by the way, I do want to just point out one brief point, which is the Rashbam's reading of it is, I don't want to go through the whole way the Rashbam reads, but he reads that the testimony about wheat and barley was that actually, just like the Gemara said later, that you were saying years 1, 3, and 5 were wheat, and the other guy was saying 2, 4, and 6 were barley. And they were actually saying that. And the issue is, in that case, right, is that considered, so if you look at the Rashbam, I just want to point out that it's very, if you take a look here, it's very interesting because he actually did some research. Okay, he says, it's 3 lines before the lines get wide. Echad omer achlan chitin gibboshanim kifi minig ov di adama. And then he says, I went and I did some research. I asked some farmers. They do it rotation of crops, right? The and you don't have to let it lay fallow if you rotate the crops. They're not contradicting because it's basically this is a normal thing to overturn it. So he has his own way of reading the Gemara, which I don't want to go into, but I just thought it was interesting that he actually did a little research and went out and asked people, hey, how does it work? Okay, and then he sort of says that's pshat of the Gemara. But at the end of the day, the reason this combines is because they mamish said that they got the details mixed up, but they are actually saying the exact same thing. Could we actually abstract if Michael says 1, 2, and 3 and David says 4, 5, and 6? Can we combine that? That never is fully answered in the Gemara. Okay, so we'll pick up with this tomorrow.
I just want to get back to the answer. Yes.